We arrived at the Grand Tetons National Park in west central Wyoming around 7 a.m. on it would have been a Monday morning, and we kind of got ourselves like mentally prepared and freshen up, and we were doing a hike.
Yeah.
This was AJ's research. Found a hike, his best hike, or the most unknown hike of Grand Tetons.
Yeah.
And that one, I believe it ended up being, was it 8 miles round trip, 3,500 feet of elevation change, or 2,500? No,
something.
It was 3,500 calories, 2,500 elevation, something. I don't know. My app told me these things. It took us 6 hours, not counting we stayed for like an hour. But Chase, you are the... You're the leader in the hikes. I mean, AJ did the research, but you keep the pace. We're doing our best to keep up with you. Without us, you would like do 5 hikes in a day without us, probably. But
yeah, maybe, I know.
Maybe.
I mean, the Grand Tetons one was difficult, especially, I mean, we all were staying up through the night, taking shifts, driving. I mean, I think I drove almost like 4 hours, and it was like Deer Valley in Wyoming. Every 10 miles, you see like a deer like literally 2 feet from you off the side of the road. You're like, oh my gosh, is it going to run? Is it going to jump? I don't know. And so like that was like keeping me on edge. I was scared to drive like the whole time.
But they tend to hang by the side of the road.
Yeah.
They're not running. Once in a while, it's only 2 or 3 times maybe the entire trip.
Right.
One darted across in front of us. For the most part, they're just eating grass on the side of the road.
Mm-hmm. And there's actually, we ran to a national forest, like deer crossing, but there's 2 huge elk, like right on the side of the road. We're like, oh my gosh, like huge elk. I'm going 25, like around the curve, and all of a sudden, boom, 2 huge elk. I'm like, oh my gosh. So it's just really, you got to be on point when you're driving at night for sure. And then I was like, okay, I'm done. I'm getting tired. I think AJ took a shift for 2 hours then. That was like, windy, like there's like wind gusts blowing the car all over creation. Like, you know, I don't know what's happening, but AJ drove through that, and then Kurt drove the last stretch, drove through the last stretch to get us to Grand Tetons. And then, so we're all running on like zero sleep, like to do like the most strenuous hike on this entire trip.
I think I had the most sleep at about like an hour and a half.
Yeah.
And for me, it's my car, and I feel so responsible for the two of you. Yes, you're adults now, but I would hate the idea of our trip being derailed by us hitting some animal, or like, it was really hard for me to sleep in the car.
That was hard for me too.
I was like, I want to stay up, and I got energy to do it, obviously. I mean,
anyways, back to the Teton.
Yeah, the Teton hike. So we start off, and it's like really flat. I'm like, go fast. We like, this is fun. Like, this is easy. We're gonna have a good time. And then there's all of a sudden there's just a shift. Like, I don't know where it's at, but probably like 2.5 miles or 3 miles. We're like, yep, my calves are on fire right now, and I don't know if we're like how much farther I can go. I mean, I felt like a pace was fine. I mean, it was nice to sometimes take a breath and relax and take some photos too. It's really scenic, especially when you climbed an elevation. We got to see just the different lakes, different nature and stuff like that. It was really beautiful.
I think out of all the hikes we had, that really had all the different elements in the hike. So it was very progressive. It started just straight walking through the woods, then you could start to get a little more elevation, and the elevation increased, and we went into switchbacks, where if you don't know what a switchback is, because we didn't know before this trip, but now we know, it's when you go back and forth up the mountainside, keep increasing in elevation, and those started to, that's when it started to get more strenuous. Okay, that's like pretty intense, and we finally got up to the point. I'm sure Chase will take it off right here, is when we got to the point where it was down the lake or the other one.
Yeah.
One thought, you had done your research, like this is the one to do, but something we kind of forgotten about is in parts of some of these states, cell phone service is not good, but on national parks, almost nowhere, because it's just, people don't live there. There's no businesses. There's no demand in that way to have good cell service. There just isn't, so... We were unsure of where to go at a certain point, and I don't know, you figured it out. And actually, we ran into a guy that helped point us in the direction of this hike that isn't labeled, that you found on the internet that was like this great hike with this great ending. Yeah. And thankfully, we were pointing in the right direction.
Yeah, so there was a fork in the road, basically, and one was to the down the lakeside, we figured out, and one was just up the mountain.
Yeah.
To see like just some lake or something, I don't know, something not as cool. But I knew going into the hike that this hike was off. It was I don't know the word, but it was off trail. It wasn't an official trail, so it wasn't maintained by the park ranger. So right. If a tree log fell down on the trail, you'd have to climb over it. They're not going to move it all the way. If rocks fell, there'd be more rocks, and you'd have to go over the rocks, something like that.
Yeah, that was. Yeah, great explanation of, like, the progression of the trail. I mean, that it's fun for me to have progressions like that, especially because it gets harder and harder as you go up, and there's lots of different things. So, yeah, we get to this fork in the road, and, like, left, you keep going up the switchbacks up to this other lake and whatever. But then if you go right towards Delta Lake, you got to go down the steps over, like, some tree branches, and then now it starts getting hard. You got to make sure you put your feet in the right place, otherwise you're slipping and sliding. I remember I was looking back, AJ and Kurt were like using the stakes or what are those poles, the poles that you had?
Trekking poles.
You have trekking poles and you're tapping around, making sure you're not going to slip and fall. And I'm just like going up and down, like trying to make sure. And then we get to the spot, like, oh my gosh, there's like a rock slide, like tons of boulders. And like, I was like waiting for the boulders. AJ was like, there's boulders on this trail, trust me. I'm like, okay, where are the boulders?
And
I'm like,
there's basically a whole mountainside.
Yeah.
Giant rocks.
Yeah, whole mountainside.
And I knew going into it that there was going to be bouldering, and that was going to be the hardest part. So by the time we got up here, I knew going into it that it wouldn't get hard until we got to the boulders. Mm-hmm. And it was very diminishing to know by the time we got to the boulders how much we actually did. So I was like, holy shit, we're not even to the hard part yet.
Basically. Yeah, right.
And so I knew when we got there, it's just a mountainside of boulders just going up for probably a quarter of a mile, just giant rocks.
Right.
We had to climb over.
Yeah, this is the hardest hike I've ever done. I think with either one or both of you a couple times, I've done Camelback Mountain in the
Arizona.
Phoenix area, Scottsdale.
Yeah.
I've done a pretty easy mountain somewhere near Las Vegas with my friend Zach. Besides that, I don't know that I'd done any until this one, and it was the hardest one I've done, maybe even before we started getting over the boulders, because I was so exhausted. It was already like 2.5 hours into it, 3 hours into it, and then we had to maneuver through the rocks, and at the final stretch going a very steep climb with some loose dirt and having to be very careful not to slip.
Yeah, and for me, like when the trail's getting harder, I'm like, that's when I get more excited, because like I'm like, yep, the reward's coming, like this is the time to push. So I'm like flying up and down the rocks, and like current age are like, Chase, wait, we don't know where we're going. And I'm like, yep, you're right. So I had to wait for them, we all figure it out, go up the trail again. And then it's like all of a sudden it's like we're going like kind of switchback, all of a sudden it's just like straight, like you gotta like bear claw like with your hands and really dig in with your feet to like get up some of these points, because there's slippery rock, it's slippery dirt, like you slip and fall if you're not careful, and it's unmaintained, so you got to be careful. And we're going up, like this is the hard part, and then I get up to the clearing, I'm waiting for AJ and Kurt, and like all of a sudden there's really snow like where we're at that level. So I'm like, oh, I'm gonna like throw snowball. So I got a snowball through that Kurt, like didn't hit him, whatever, but
you threw more than one snowball at me.
Yeah, I mean it was fun. I mean I was like, there's snow in the mountain
you.
In like the middle of June, like this is crazy.
I
like,
remember before we started the hike we saw the snow and just like dismissed the fact that we'd ever go up that high, and then we'd reach the snow. It's like, oh wow.
Yeah, we're like in snow-capped mountains. And so yeah, we're up there, we get to this beautiful lake. It's just pristine, tranquil, like lake, it's calm, there's some people there, nobody's like in the water at all, just like relaxing like it's a beach.
It's really perfect, because when you were walking up just right past the hardest part of the climb, I'd say, right?
Yeah,
it's just you're basically hands and feet crawling up the side of the dirt rocky trail, and you just basically go under a branch and there's a big boulder, and you basically walk around and you see the view as soon as you come around the corner. You see the view of the glacier runoff lake and the biggest Teton or whatever in the background.
Yeah, Grand Teton.
Perfect view. Kurt will have pictures of it.
Yeah, it was, I think for me, that was the most beautiful view on the trip. I don't know if you guys agree, but for me, that was just the most beautiful, most pristine, most picturesque view we saw the whole time. That as soon as you enter on that view right there, it's just it's awestruck. I was just like, my mouth, my jaw dropped, and it's like, oh my gosh, we're here in a mountain. And then there's this beautiful glacier runoff lake. So.
And for me, I guess that's another one of the big surprises. I knew that there was a lake somewhere, but I had no comprehension of what it would look like. And it couldn't have been more picturesque.
I mean, for me, I don't know, like, it was like a teal. AJ, you want to chime in? What color, like, would you describe it?
A lot. I kind of came up with it when we were there. It was like an emerald kind of looking lake, and it's the glacier runoff, and it's freezing cold. I'm sure Chase will go into that.
Yeah, it's a freezing cold lake, and I'll tell you how we got into that a little bit later. But I want to focus on the color, because it was just like, you don't see lakes this like clear, but with this beautiful color. It's bold, but it's like calming, and it's just pretty. It's got like, it's just so unique, just how this lake is colored. Like, if you like this stuff, if you like hiking, you like making the trips and stuff like that, go see this lake. It's beautiful. I think it's one of It's like a bucket list, like one of the things that you want to see before you're gone. Like, that's just my opinion on it.
So that's Delta Lake at Grand Tetons. It's hard to find, so you're going to Google it or ask us.
Google it.
But when we got up there, people were hanging near the shore, maybe like 50 people scattered around the lake, something like that.
Right.
And I think off in the distance is a couple of people going in the water. But up until then, we really hadn't seen much of that. And Chase, we as it happens occasionally, we lose Chase for a little bit. He's off by himself. He was up somewhere in the rocks changing into his swim trunks, and he came back.
Yeah, so I came back with my swim trunks because I'm like, I went on this long hike, this strenuous hike. I'm tired. I want to take a swim, want to cool off and stuff. And so I'm like, whew, like, let's take a dip. And then I get in, and it's like, ooh, that's a little cold. I'm walking through it. I get to this rock that's out there. And I'm like, whew, like, that wasn't too bad. Like, walking through it is cool, but I was like, I didn't fully experience it yet. So I'm just sitting on this rock. I'm like trying to get AJ to come out. He's getting ready. He's getting his GoPro and stuff ready and stuff like that. And then Kurt's like, all right, Chase, I'm going to take a video of you. I'm like, what is he wanting me to do on this video? In my head, I'm like, am I supposed to jump in? And so he's like, 5, 4, 3, 2. I'm like, oh, I don't know what to do. So I'm just like looking in. I'm like, ah, it looks fine. I'm going to jump in. All of a sudden, I jump. Everyone's like, oh, shit, what are you doing? Like, so I jump in. I'm like, whoo, gets out. Like, all of a sudden, like, my sinuses clear up. It was so cold. It smacks in your face. And I was just like, whoo, like, surprised me, shocked me. Like, oh, like, this is freezing. And so I swim out. I'm like, scream, like, woo! Like, and I was like, whoa, that's nippy, man. Because, like, I'm just shivering that, like, as soon as I get out of the water. And I was like, oh, my gosh. Like, the guy, like, actually just jumped in. And I'm, like, chilling. I'm, like, whew. You know, I feel good. I'm, like, dang. I'm, like, I just did that. Nobody else is doing that. Like, I just jumped in. Like, no problem. So I'm just relaxing there. And then everybody else is, like, oh, like, maybe we should do it. And it was really cool.
Yeah, we saw probably 10 other people. AJ ended up doing it, too. I didn't come prepared to go in the water. Plus, my swimming isn't so good. So those are my excuses this time. But but seeing you do it makes me realize that I'll be prepared for the next opportunity, then I'll have to do it.
Yeah. Chase was just so influential. I was trying to get over there. The rocks on the way were, like, very sharp. So you had to be very careful. And the water was, like, clear, but it was very, like, emeraldy and, like, see in it, so you couldn't see the rocks on the bottom.
Right.
So you had to feel it out, and it was kind of hard to get there, and I got my GoPro ready. By the time I was there, this couple was already ready to jump in, and they were like kind of like hesitant, and they're like, oh, should we do this? And Chase was like, go for it.
Yeah, I'm like,
they end up jumping in right before I do.
Yeah.
And then by the time they jumped in, and we're done, and we're all heading out, like 50 people are starting.
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah, there's like, I was like, oh, join the 1% club. I'm like, nobody else is doing this. Join the 1% club, and then everybody's doing it. It kind of ruins it, but it's like, hey, you know what? I got people to, like, jump in this cold lake. It's a thing there.
The plan initially was to jump in the lake is because I saw that was an actual thing. By the time we got there, it was kind of like, okay, we're going to go jump in the lake, but it was cold. So it was kind of like, should we jump in the lake? I don't know.
Yeah, you got a really good video on GoPro, I think, of that. Yes. Like, it was this perfect timing. Like, we get up, and then you turn around, and then there's the view. Like, you're in the lake. I mean, it's one of those, just, I'm never going to forget that experience. I'm going to talk about it, like, with my kids. I'm going to take my kids there. I'm going to make them jump in the lake. I'm going to push them in if they don't want to go. I don't care.
Yikes.
I mean, you just got to do some of that stuff. You got to go for it.
Oh, my. So, Chase mentioned it. He mentioned the feeling when he went into the water. that was like, it's just like that therapy. It was very therapeutic.
Yeah, therapeutic.
We went in and we were obviously just got done with like a 3-hour, 3.5-hour hike, whatever it was. It was very strenuous. We're all dirty, caked in like dirt, snow, rock, cut up, whatever. Yeah. And just jumping in automatically, you just feel so
rejuvenated.
Rejuvenated. It was so therapeutic, and I felt I probably have not felt better in like a split second time span of like not feeling good or not. It wasn't not feeling good. I obviously just accomplished, but I was worn down to like feeling like, oh my god, I just woke up from the best sleep of my life.
Yeah, this trip was one of those trips that I think it's going to be one of those where it's more times than I've had in my life so far where it's like I feel alive doing this. And it's like when you jump into that lake, you're like, I feel alive. It's like an awakening within your spirit where it's like you unleash the beast or something like that. I don't know if like you guys felt the similar energy, but for me, I was doing all sorts of stuff where it's like, I feel alive. I feel alive. And that was kind of just like, I didn't really, just talking about it right now. It's like, that was my thing. That was my mindset. It's like, I want to feel alive and awake, like I'm living, like I'm doing stuff.
And that's the thing about traveling, it gets us out of our routine. Like I don't look at myself as a hiker or a mountain climber, but we're out here, we're seeing national parks. This is a thing you can do. I'm with you, and you want to do that, and you want to do that. Like, it wouldn't have been my idea to climb these mountains, but I'm also not going to not go with you. So it forces me into different situations. And I think that's just the idea. You get to somewhere new, you're with some people that have some different ambitions. And the correct answer almost always should be yes. Just, okay, someone wants to do it. Unless you've done it before and hate it, maybe then say no and do something else. Yeah. But I'd never climbed that mountain before. I'd never gone on an 8-mile hike before. And I didn't have I had nothing else going on for 10 days. So there's no reason not to go if I'm physically capable of doing it. And I proved to myself that I am physically capable of doing that. Mm-hmm. I didn't jump in the water. I put my feet in the water, and that was enough for me in that moment. But that's certainly a lasting memory of, okay, I did that. That's the toughest hike I've ever done. I could do something tougher. But now I've raised my average. I set a new baseline for what I'm capable of doing. And I think, so that was about 6 hours. I bet it was actually 3.5 hours up and 2.5 back, something like that.
Yep.
And so let's get to the going down the mountain. Pretty standard, just one foot in front of the other for the most part. Once we got back to the main trail, going down the switchbacks is easier. It just takes a long time because it was so many miles. Right. But at a certain point, we found a little surprise.
Yeah, I want to get into that. So we're walking down the mountain again, going down the switchbacks, and there's like a rustling in the bushes. Kurt's like literally 6 feet away from this, 10 feet, 7 feet, whatever it is. And I'm like, Kurt, what is that? Like, stop. Like, there's an animal right by you. And like, we're waiting. I'm like, what is that? And it jumps out, and it's a baby cub. It's like a grizzly cub or like a brown bear cub.
One of the two. We didn't do a DNA test.
I'm like, oh my gosh. Yeah, it's a bear. It's a bear cub. Like, who cares? It's a bear cub. And I'm like, okay, Kurt's running back here. AJ gets the bear spray out of my pack. He gives me the bear spray. I'm like, I'm just watching this thing. Everybody's got their phones out taking videos. And like, we see some people coming up behind us. They come up behind us. We're like, there's a baby bear.
So I went back. I'm like, I don't want to alarm you, or maybe I should alarm you. There's a bear cub ahead of us, and we have no idea if there's a mother bear around.
Right. Right, because that's the danger part. When the mama comes around, she's going to protect that thing and just going to go like Malia or whatever she has to do. So I got the bear spray. I'm ready. I'm looking around, like head on a swivel. I'm like, where is this mama bear? Because I'm at the front. I'm getting eaten first. If this is what's going to happen, I'll die, whatever. And that's just going. Well, there's a million thoughts going through my head right now. I'm like, there's a baby bear on this trail.
The mother bear is not going to get all of us. Maybe with enough of us, she'll run away herself. Who knows? But the bear cub began to just kind of walk forward on the trail. But it's walking on the trail. This trail has miles to go. Who knows when it's going to leave our area.
Yeah.
Chase had a good analogy. It looked like Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, yeah. It looked like
wandering.
Yeah, just like, doo-doo-doo, I want to eat my honey. Ooh, like, Piglet, where are you? Like, you know, it was just
not
like
a care in the world.
Yeah, it's just having a good time. It was such a cute little bear. But, like, if you see the mother, then you're like, that bear was a trap. Now we're all dead or whatever, you know. Like, it was just that, it was crazy to just see that so close in nature. You don't get those experiences often. So, I mean, that's just one of the things I really appreciate about Grand Teton is just going there and just seeing just nature and wild, it's just like, it's so pure, and like there's nothing like harming anything. It's just like you just go and you get to see animals in their like natural state, which is really cool.
So we wrap up that hike, we get down, we're filthy, and to this point we had left on Sunday afternoon from Minnesota, yeah, and this was Monday in the evening. And me being me on this trip and not wanting to plan too much to force us to a new one spot, we didn't have a place to stay yet.
Right.
And we were near, Grand Tetons is closest to Jackson, Wyoming. And Jackson Hole, Wyoming is like a slightly different place, but it's all very close, as best as I can understand. We drove to Jackson. I ended up getting a hotel that was outrageously priced, but less outrageously priced than all the other ones.
That was a hostel, right?
It used to be a hostel, and I think they kind of transitioned to being more like a hotel, but it really felt like a hostel because we all had single beds.
Yeah.
But we had our own private room. Yeah. So when we stayed there, that was, I think, Teton Village. We had a meal in Jackson. And this city, I don't know what it's like most of the year, but it seems to be just one of these happening resort towns.
Yeah.
Not very big, but a lot of restaurants, a lot of people around.
Yeah.
I think they had like some kind of 1800s reenactment going on down the street. We didn't see it, but it seemed like a cool place to go.
Right.
Be prepared to spend more money than maybe you'd want to on a given day, but go there and check it out.
Yeah.
So we stayed at Teton Village, and this ended up being the trend. We didn't, three of the nights, we didn't stay at a hotel. We ended up like driving through the night. But the days that we did stay, we slept, like, we're already tired, so we kind of slept as much as we could. And that day, that was, Chase, that was your 18th birthday on the Tuesday morning. And you seemed to not be in a hurry to get out of bed, so I'm like, all right, we'll just sleep in. We got to Yellowstone Park at, like, noon. Not a great idea. Probably get there early. We, using Bill, our guidance, our voice on this Gypsy app, we went through about half of the park in about 8 hours. They say 2 day minimum to really do it, and I understand now it probably does take you 2 days, but from there I don't think we'll spend a lot of time on it. There's some neat sights, lots of geysers. We saw Old Faithful. Make sure you're not like standing in the wind so you can get a better view of it, but it's a cool place.
It's a quality.
Being like 20 miles away or whatever Grand Tetons and Yellowstone are away from each other, two totally different national park experiences. Tetons is very much more wilderness, and obviously we took more of a challenge on that hike, but it was much more wildernessy, where Yellowstone was a lot more touristy, lots of photos, lots of vines, lots of people, where it was just such a different kind of vibe that they each had.
Yeah, if you're going to Tetons or most of these, you're going there with your backpacks and water and ready to really put in some work. Yellowstone, it can be the lazy person's national park. You just go stop to stop and take pictures, which is okay. We did some of that too, but it's definitely, it draws more people because it has that ability to just park your car and walk 20 feet and take pictures.
Right. I mean, it was a quality experience though. I mean, for me, I just like the geological factors of it was just so unique, and seeing how all that stuff works and how we have that in America. It's like, you never think like, oh, America's got all this stuff. And it's like, oh my gosh, we have like one of the most unique places on the planet, and people are coming all over to see this place. And like, what do they say, like 3 million people annually visit there?
It's
crazy.
And these parks, the ones that we went to, they're all in the middle of nowhere, the part of the country that most people, unless you're like there, you don't really think about it.
Yeah.
Like, what would anyone do in Wyoming or Montana or Idaho or Utah? It's like, oh, all these things. These are really, really cool.
Yeah, it's really cool. I mean, I think maybe one thing we could do is like recap all the unique features of all these parks and stuff at the end, just to really like embrace that, because there were this every place we went seemed to like have a little bit there, a little bit here. This is what made that unique. This is what made that cool. And so
it's definitely unique for a while, because so day one it was on the Sunday we went to Badlands and Mount Rushmore. Day two, Grand Tetons on a Monday. Your birthday on the Tuesday, we went to Yellowstone. And from there, we drove overnight to Glacier, which we've already talked about.
Yep.
Saw a bit of the park. And but to see the other side of the park would have taken a six-hour drive. It just, the timing wasn't there for us.
Yep.
So we spent the least amount of time there of the parks that we really wanted to see.